Well, good evening and blessed Sabbath soon.
Amen. Amen.
I'd like to begin with a word of prayer, so I invite you to kneel. Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful and blessed to have this privilege to meet together, to fellowship, to study, to worship together. We thank you for the work that you're doing in hearts around the world, for the testimonies we've heard tonight. And we pray that you will bless us in a special way with your presence tonight and on this Sabbath coming up. And we pray for a rich measure of your Spirit, that you will anoint your servant with a coal from off the altar. And give us receptive hearts and minds, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I was really blessed by the testimonies tonight. Yes. It's always a privilege to hear the what God is doing.
Amen.
And we were in Mindanao a few months ago, which is an island, one of the larger islands in the Philippines. We spent about 6 or 8 weeks there on a missionary trip, and we visited one church after another, one group after another, and everywhere we were finding people, hundreds of people, that had just accepted this message, this truth about God in the last, 6 months or so. And there were two schools that were operating, missionary schools. And there's a sanitarium there. There's already a sanitarium that our brethren operate up in the Luzon, the northern island. And now there was one there in this southern island, the southernmost province. We found the same problems we see everywhere with people being torn and pulled this way and that way with various winds of doctrine. And we did what we could to share and to try to ground the people there. And there were, I believe, three conference churches that had several hundred members that invited me to speak. And at each one, I shared the truth about God. And this is unusual, but because the conference over there, like everywhere, the conference officials have warned people about receiving anybody that doesn't have the credentials and the permission from the conference to speak. And I was at I was chased off from a school in Philippines, and so anyway, this was just a providence that the Lord opened up. There were some, it turned out that there were people that were in leadership positions at these churches that had accepted the truth about God, and they hadn't made a big stink about it, a big issue about it yet. They had shared with certain other leaders and certain elders, and so anyway, things were still open for them to be able to arrange for speakers, and so God opened those doors. And many of the people that we came across just found this truth just by studying on their own. They just were reading, and God showed the truth to them. Many of the people had accepted the Sabbath even, and many of the distinctive truths that we hold just from studying the Bible on their own. And we found someone in Malaysia that just found it on his own. We found someone in Thailand. He's actually, the one in Thailand is working for, we found various ones that believe the truth there in Thailand, but this one individual was working as the manager of Sanitarium Foods factory. They have a factory in Australia, and they have other factories elsewhere where they produce health, in quotation marks, health foods. And they, he's the manager there. He studied and just learned this truth on his own about 10 years ago. And about, I forget how many years ago, how long he's been living in Thailand, do you remember? He's from Brazil, he's Caucasian, and about 10 years in Thailand. Okay, before he accepted that job, he said, I've got to be up front. And he said, he went to the ones that were offering him the job, the people who operated Sanitarium Foods, and he says, I've got to be straight with you. I don't believe like you believe. This is the way I believe. And he shared the way he believed. But if you want me to work there, I'll work there. And they hired him. And so he's been working there. He is attending a mainstream church and has shared it with the pastor and with the elders. And 3 out of 5 elders, as well as the pastor, have accepted this. And they actually changed the baptismal vow before they baptized people. I don't know how they're getting along with the conference, but anyway, God is working in hearts all over the world. When we went to Cambodia, because of a contact that Mara had, a friend that had attended the Mountain View College, where she had been attending, and he's now pastoring in Cambodia, and he's a Cambodian. He just had gone to Philippines to study, and he's working as the chaplain or whatever of, and a Bible teacher at a school that's a self-supporting school. They have 200 and something students and about 50 staff members. They have people from various nationalities that are on the staff. And through that contact, anyway, he invited us to do a week of prayer there. So we held a week of prayer with meetings every evening. And we were able to leave books with the teachers and with him and share the truth with him. And so these are some people we can keep in prayer. All over the world, you know, Brother John Christophe has shared what's going on in France and Martinique and Reunion, and we've heard tonight. And so I'm just encouraged as I hear how God is working in lives all over the world. And when you see how the same message, the same truth is coming to people on their own, through random people, just all over the world, you know that this is not just a human devising. This is not something that has come from human lips. This is something of divine origin. So it was a blessing to hear those things tonight. Tonight our message is called The Golden Clasp. It's about the Sabbath. One author has stated, the Sabbath is a golden clasp that unites God and His people. We will take a look tonight at the Sabbath, several aspects of the Sabbath. As with all truths, there's many different aspects you can look at. We will be taking a look at a couple of these aspects tonight. In the book Story of Redemption, it tells us that after the earth was created and the beasts upon it, the Father and the Son carried out their purpose, which was designed before the fall of Satan, to make man in their own image. They, had wrought together in the creation of the earth and every living thing upon it. And now God said to his Son, let us make man in our image. In Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, after the creation of the earth in 6 days, we read, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. There were two special institutions that we receive from Eden. And the first one was marriage. And man was made in the image of God, which we were noticing last night. The second institution is the Sabbath. And Adam and Eve had only been around for less than probably just a few hours, because before they were created on the sixth day, there were all these animals that were created. So they were the last thing that was made. And so they had not been around for 6 days needing rest now for the Sabbath. It wasn't a rest per se from physical things that they needed. They were just created. But God created a rest day based on the fact that he had rested from his work. And not that God gets tired, but there are different kinds of rests. There are rests such as in America, July 4. There are rests that we make holidays. These are days that we're supposed to remember things, Remembrance Day, or Veterans Day, or these different days, different institutions that are meant to bring to mind, to celebrate something. And this was not a celebration, but it was a memorial. It was a time that God set apart for us to remember creation, for us to keep in mind that we had a creator, that we were the creation. And God stopped and stepped back and observed the work that he had done. And he took that time to spend with man. It was a special day for mankind. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 23, we read that he said unto them, this is that which the Lord has said, tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Now, this is when Israel's in the wilderness. This is prior to the giving of the Ten Commandments. I bring us to these scriptures to remind us that the Sabbath was instituted before the law of God was given on Sinai. It was instituted before Israel was in the wilderness. And as we saw there, it's an institution that came from Eden at the very creation. It was the day that God rested. And we don't find any other day that God has blessed and sanctified. He has set it apart. There's no other day. And here we notice that the law is mentioned, that the Sabbath is mentioned before the law was given. In Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11, we see the basis for the Sabbath. It says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son nor thy daughter, thy manservant nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates, etc. The Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. The basis for the Sabbath is that God created the world in 6 days, and He rested on the seventh. In the law given from Sinai, God recognized the week and the facts upon which it is based. If the days of the week are literal, then so is the Sabbath. The Sabbath, then, is a powerful testimony to the Creator creating this world in 6 literal days. There are a lot of people questioning creation. Evolutionists. And people who somehow try to mingle Christianity and evolution. People that claim to be Seventh-day Adventists are doing this. Teachers at Seventh-day Adventist colleges are doing this. And so, the very fact that the week exists is a testimony to that fact. A week of 7 days. And if the days, I'll read that point again, if the days of the week are literal, then so is the Sabbath. And if the Sabbath is kept, then we're going to recognize the literal days of the week, because the Sabbath had its origin in creation. So you can't be a Seventh-day Adventist Sabbath keeper and be an evolutionist. It's not harmonious. So I want us to notice another point about the Sabbath, and that is that it's the seal of God. And we were talking about last night in Revelation 13 the mark, or the beast that is mentioned in Daniel, or in Revelation chapter 13. It goes on to talk about another beast, and we will be talking about tomorrow night how this beast will implement a mark. But before we learn what that mark is, I want us to notice what God's mark is. God's sign, His seal. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 2, we read, "And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God." So God has a seal, a golden clasp, if you will, to bind Himself to His people. We read in the Webster's Dictionary that a seal is, there are various meanings of seal. A piece of metal or other hard substance, usually round or oval, on which is engraved some image or device, and sometimes a legend or inscription. This is used by individuals, corporate bodies, and states for making impressions on wax upon instruments of writing, as an evidence of their authenticity. The wax set to an instrument and impressed or stamped with a seal is the second definition. So it can be the instrument doing the sealing, or it can be the impression left, or I should say the material that the seal is placed in, the wax. When we've had to do some documents for governments, for visas and so forth, and passports, we've had to get various documents like birth certificates or letters and so forth notarized. It's got to have a seal on it from someone who has checked out the authenticity of our documents, of our identity, etc. And so these are two of the definitions for seal. It can also be something which binds or holds fast a letter or other paper, that which confirms any act of confirmation, or that which confirms, ratifies, or makes stable, that which effectually shuts, confines, or secures, that which makes fast. It's also a verb which means to fasten. It's the act of fastening with a seal, to attach together with a wafer or with a wax to seal a letter, to set or affix a seal as a mark of authenticity, or to confirm, to ratify, to establish, to shut up, close up, etc. To make fast. Number six, to mark with a stamp as evidence of quality. Number seven, to keep secret. To mark as one's property, secure from danger, to close, to fulfill, to complete, to imprint on, as to seal instruction. So, summarizing the meanings of seal, it's the instrument doing the sealing, it's the impression left, confirmation or state of being sealed, or the act of placing a seal, leaving an impression. These are the definitions that relate more especially to what we're dealing with here when we're talking about God's seal. A seal basically contains three things: the name, the title, the jurisdiction. And this is not new to most of you probably, but a seal establishes authenticity. It establishes the authority of something. In chapter 8, verse 16 of Isaiah, we read that God tells us, "Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples." When someone receives a law, or you see a copy of a law, if you don't know where that law comes from, it has no authority with you. It could be a law from China, or Philippines, or somewhere else. It has no bearing upon you unless you see who it's from and the authority from which it came. And God's law needs to have a seal as well. And if it doesn't reveal who the law is from, you could observe that law, thou shalt not take the name of, and I'll leave out parts of it, the name of God in vain. If you don't know what God that's talking about, you could apply that to the Hindu God, to the Buddhist God, to any other God. So we need to know where it's from. And God's law needs to be sealed. Why is God telling us to seal it? Is it not sealed? Did he not seal it? It's to be sealed among the disciples, among God's people. Yes, God sealed it. There's a seal there. But we have removed the seal by our actions. When we're not keeping the Sabbath, we are telling the world that God is not really the author of this law, because we have taken the authority to change it ourselves. Man has no authority to change what comes from God, to ignore what comes from God. And by doing that, we are ignoring the authority of the lawgiver. So God tells us, bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. In Isaiah 58, verse 12, we read that they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. And if thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shalt honor him, not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words. Notice that we see foretold here in prophecy a time when God's people would be raising up foundations, old foundations, foundations of many generations. They would be repairing a breach, restoring paths to dwell in. God is talking about the breach made in his law. The fact that for much of this world's history, God's people have ignored the fourth commandment, or they've been ignorant of it, especially during the Dark Ages. when the Sabbath was forgotten by a large part of the people. The Waldenses kept the Sabbath for a number of years. I saw an actual principles of faith, or forget what they called it. It wasn't exactly principles of faith, but anyway, it was equivalent to a principles of faith of the Waldenses, dated in the 11th century, the early 11th century, and it was included the Sabbath. And I saw one after that that was dated around 11 something, and the Sabbath was not there. And so I have concluded, at least in that area where this was published, there was a change in their beliefs during that century. And there's a lot of accusations and evidence from their opponents, from the Catholics, about the Waldenses keeping the Sabbath. They give evidence to the fact that they were keeping the Sabbath. That statement of beliefs that I saw in a history book, I believe it was a history book by Samuel Morse, if I'm not mistaken. But when I went back and tried to find that book, I couldn't find it. And I looked a lot of places to try to find that book, and I couldn't find it. Any copy of it to get a copy, an actual copy of that. But I don't know exactly the name of the book, and I've been unable to find it, unfortunately, since then. But this was I saw it when I was in Toronto, in Hamilton. Not Toronto, but Hamilton. But in Exodus chapter 20, verse 8, we read, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath." And then in verse 11, we read, "For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." So we see I want to say title, but there's another word that I'm looking for. It depicts who God is, what He's doing. He's the Creator. And here in the previous verses, it says, "The Lord thy God." This word "Lord," when you find it all in caps in the King James Version, it's translated from the Hebrew word Jehovah. And so this is the name of God here, and His title, and His jurisdiction is mentioned in what He's created. "For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is." So it tells us that God has jurisdiction over everything. So we see the seal of God in this fourth commandment. We don't find it anywhere else. We find mention of the name of God, but we don't find all three of these points that a seal must contain. A sign, we find, is synonymous with a seal. In Romans 4:11, "And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet being uncircumcised." I won't say it's exactly synonymous, but they are used to bring out various aspects of the same thing. And so sign or seal can be used to speak of the same thing. In Ezekiel 20, verse 12, we read, "Moreover also I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them." Verse 20, "Hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God." So it's called a sign of two different things, that the Lord is our God, firstly, and secondly, that that He is the one that does what?
Sanctifies
us. God could have chosen any of the commandments to be a sign. He could have chosen what you wear to be a sign. He could have chosen anything. But He chose the Sabbath. What is different about the Sabbath than thou shalt not steal, or thou shalt not bear false witness, or anything else? What's different about the Sabbath? Okay, that's all of these things are true, but it allows us to spend time with Him. It's a time period. What?
It's not passive. It's active. You're taking part in something, not doing something.
Okay. Okay. And it's significant that it's a rest. That it's a time period. And how does God sanctify us?
Through His Word.
Through His Word. And by what? I heard it somewhere.
Sanctify them by the law.
Truth.
Sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. And in order to have that word sanctify us, it requires time. It requires our time. God wants our time. He wants us to take time to read His word, time to listen to Him, time to commune with Him, time to fellowship with Him. God has chosen, because His word, backing up, His word is the expression of His thoughts, His mind. How do you receive someone's thoughts? How do you know what they're thinking? You have to take time to listen, time to commune. And this is the way God is able to sanctify us, is when we take that time for Him. And so the Sabbath, which is a time period that God has set apart, has been made a sign that God sanctifies us. In Exodus 31:13, again, it's called a sign, that you may know that I am the Lord that does sanctify you. The last statement there. The Sabbath is the great test question. It is the line of demarcation between the loyal and true and the disloyal and transgressor. It is the seal of the living God. Selected Messages, Book 3. Just corroborating what we have just found from the Bible. That the Sabbath is the seal of the living God. So, here in Revelation 7, it's talking about the seal of God. In Revelation 14, verse 1, we read that there's a lamb standing on the Mount Zion, and with him is a group of people that have something in their foreheads. They have the Father's name. Now, it's interesting that a name signifies character. In Exodus 33, verse 18, Moses asked to see God's glory. And God said, I will make my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. So God says, I'm going to proclaim the name of the Lord before thee. Now, Moses already had gone through this with God before. Moses had said, God, who shall I say is sending me? And God had said, I am. And so now we read that God says, I'm going to proclaim my name. There's something more significant than simply saying David Sims or Jehovah. We read in Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7, when God actually does this, we read, "And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, 'The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and to the fourth generation.'" So it declares God's character. God's character of mercy, long-suffering, goodness and truth, but also God's character of justice. We find both the mercy and the justice of God in the name, in the proclamation of the name. Name signifies character. And there are people that should know better, that are going around saying that God never kills. God never destroys. God never forces. And what kind of justice is that? It's not justice. And, you know, you can reason with them till forever. And because they have adopted the been hypnotized to the point where when they read the scriptures, they interpret it however they want. Because you can find thousands upon thousands of statements in the scriptures that speak of God's judgment. The seven plagues we studied this morning, Nadab and Abihu, Hophni and Phinehas, the Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, Noah and his ark and the flood, and the list goes on and on. But they have to reinterpret. When it says, "Angel of the Lord slew 185,000 Assyrians," oh, but that was the Lord Satan. That's what is written in their books. Or when it says the destroying angel came and destroyed the firstborn. Well, that's Satan. You know, the destroyer is Satan, right? And so this is the epitome of private interpretation, where you read the scriptures and you interpret it how you want. You put your own slant on it. Brother John Christoph brought out something about what the real meaning of love is. Sometimes love has to discipline. It's not love for a judge of the land to let a murderer go free and go out and continue to kill. So love, just as much as justice, demands that God be a just God. Now tonight's topic is not whether God kills or not. But when we're talking about having the seal of God, brothers and sisters, you can't have the seal of God, which indicates that his name is written on your forehead, when you're believing these kinds of winds of doctrines. You're not preparing for the seal of God when you're doing that, when you're believing those things. Unfortunately, just in the last few months, we've had to confront this teaching. So this group of people that have the Father's name written on their foreheads have the Father's character. They have God's character. The forehead is the frontal lobe. It's the place where the thoughts, it's the place where the mind is, and the thoughts are being formed. And so it signifies character when the Father's name is written on their foreheads. In Ephesians 1:13, We read, in whom all ye also trusted, that after ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Here, the Apostle Paul is speaking to the Ephesians and to other Christians. He's mentioning that they had been sealed, past tense, with the Holy Spirit. So how do we relate that? I thought the seal was the Sabbath. Why is it seeming to say that the seal is the Holy Spirit now? Which is it? Let's read a few more verses and see if we can find out. Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. Just to finish that thought there. In 2 Corinthians 1:22, we read, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. So the seal is synonymous with receiving the Spirit in our hearts. What is the Spirit?
Jesus' grace.
Could you say it's the mind of Christ? The thoughts, the character of Christ? So when we receive that in our hearts, we are receiving the character of Christ. We are being sealed. So bear in mind that seal has several meanings. Seal, first of all, is the instrument that does the sealing. Secondly, it's the impression that is left from the seal. Okay, so what is the instrument that does the sealing, we read? The Sabbath. The Sabbath is the instrument that God uses. And the seal, or the Spirit, I should say, is the impression that's left in our hearts. The mind of God, the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Yes?
I'm not sure if you touched on another definition, but when you seal, like you put a seal on like a canning fruit, like it seals the bad out, you know, the air, anything that would defile it, and seals it and protects it, right?
Well, this process, yes, confirmation and the state of being sealed. So this process being accomplished in our lives preserves us. It keeps us. So all of those definitions are involved in this sealing process. But it can be confusing when we're talking about the seal because there are these different definitions. So we need to keep in mind the context and how we're using the word at the time. I'm going to skip some of these that may be covered later by others. But notice when the decree goes forth and the stamp is impressed, the character will remain pure, like you're talking about. Okay, so in Romans 4:11, and he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had, yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. We read this a little earlier. But notice now the point that who is this talking about? If you back up a few verses, you find out that it's talking about Abraham. Okay? And so it's telling us that he was sealed. And these people were sealed, these early Christians. Each one of these verses, Ephesians 4:30, 2 Corinthians 1:22, Ephesians 1:13, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, tells us that these people were sealed. So sealing is character, or I should say the impression left, using the seal in that context, is character. But different instruments are used at different times. Sabbath, as well as some other things that we'll come to here in a moment. Only those who receive the seal of the living God will have the passport through the gates of the holy city. So everybody that is saved has to be sealed. That's like a passport. You can't travel to other countries without a passport. Here in Faith I Live By, it tells us just as soon as the people of God are sealed in their foreheads, it is not any seal or mark that can be seen, but a settling into the truth. And what is it that sanctifies us? John 17:17. His word. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Okay? The word is the expression of the thoughts of God. It's his spirit, his mind. And it's a settling into the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so they cannot be moved. Just as soon as God's people are sealed and prepared for the shaking, it will come. Indeed, it has begun already. The judgments of God are now upon the land, that we may know what is coming. So notice this point now. There have been different testing truths in different time periods. In Noah's day, it was get in the ark. In Lot's day, it was get out of Sodom. In Jesus' day, believe that he is the Son of God. And in our day, especially the Sabbath, is the great test in question. And so, this is the distinction in the seal that they received and our seal. It's not a different seal. Don't ever think that there's more than one seal. There's one seal. Because the seal is the impression left. It's the character of God. And there's just, God's character doesn't change. So, but what does change is the instrument that can decide your eternal destiny. When we reject truth, whatever that truth is, the Holy Spirit departs eventually after enough time goes by and God keeps trying and trying and trying and we keep rejecting and rejecting and rejecting, we eventually sear our conscience and the Holy Spirit is withdrawn. And so truth, and backing up here, it's a settling into the truth. Truth describes God's character. Truth is who God is, what he's about. In Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11, we read here the Sabbath commandment. And notice the words, any work. We're not to do any work. In Exodus 16:23, which we looked at, we didn't comment on this part though, says, tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which you will bake today, and seethe that you will seethe. In other words, boil that which you will boil, and that which remaineth over, lay it for you to be kept until the morning. So on the preparation day, they were to do their baking, do their boiling, their cooking, and prepare in this way for the Sabbath. So they wouldn't have to spend unnecessary time in the kitchen and they could devote the hours to worship and communion with God. Now, we find some statements in the Spirit of Prophecy which balance this out just a little bit, telling us in cold weather and it's not necessary to eat cold food or something. Warming food that's already prepared is not a violation of the Sabbath commandment. But the preparation is to be done prior. And so we find something interesting though. In Leviticus 23:24, we read, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, ye shall have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, a holy convocation. This is a Sabbath based on a date. This is an annual Sabbath, a ceremonial Sabbath. Sabbath means rest. So God is saying this is a rest. And so we find several of these, actually, several of these annual or ceremonial Sabbaths. But there is a distinction in how they were to be kept. We read in Leviticus 23:7, in the first day you shall have a holy convocation, you shall do no servile work. So here's a distinction in the type of work. Okay, on the ceremonial Sabbath, they could do work that was not servile work, but they were not to do servile work. And it goes on to say, and in the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be an holy convocation to you. This is the first and seventh days of the Passover. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat. This is the distinction. This is talking about a ceremonial Sabbath, just like that is. The cooking was something which was allowed on these ceremonial Sabbaths. But the other work they were not to do. And on the Sabbath, on the seventh day Sabbath, God had said, thou shalt not do what?
Any work.
So there is a distinction in the way that these were kept. These ceremonial Sabbaths fell upon the first day of the seventh month, the 10th day of the seventh month, the 15th day of the seventh month, and the 22nd of the seventh month. It also fell on the 15th day of the first month and the 21st day of the first month. All of these were ceremonial Sabbaths. They were Sabbaths, they were days that they would set apart for a holy purpose, but they could still cook. There are those that have come up with new theories on how to keep the Sabbath, or I should say, when the Sabbath actually is. And they have established dates for their Sabbaths, where the 8th day of the month, the 15th, and the 22nd, and the 29th are Sabbaths every month. So this floats from on different days of the week. So some days, some months, it might be Sunday. Sometimes Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday, or it can be any day of the week. And there's not an unbroken cycle. I'm not going to get into this too much tonight. That's not my topic. But there are various false teachings about the Sabbath. And I only mention this, I mean, it's so far out there, so ludicrous, and I'm just being straightforward, that I wouldn't even mention it, but there are people that have accepted it, that are otherwise believers in the same truth. And Satan has gotten these people deceived into thinking that our weekly cycle is based on the calendar. Many of the ones that I'm acquainted with have, after time, given up any kind of, well, given up the weekly Sabbath right away, but given up even this after a short time, because this is based on a lunar calendar, which doesn't match up with our solar calendar. And so they have to do a lot of calculations, and there's no biblical injunction as to how to even calculate when the new moon is, from which they base this lunar calendar.
It changes every month.
And yeah, it doesn't go along with our solar calendar. So anyway, I'm sad when I see people that it seem to be honest people that are misled and deceived into some of these errors. But when the Sabbath is such an important issue that it's the seal of God, it's the sign of God, and it is the great test question in this time period that we're living in, we better be pretty sure, absolutely sure, about how to keep it, when to keep it.
Amen.
It's an important thing. So these are just those are just a few of the hundreds of things we could show from Scripture how it's impossible to prove a lunar Sabbath from the Scriptures. There was a man that I studied with that just last year, 2017, that had accepted the truth about God when Brother Morgan was there. But the devil came in really quick and started planting those tares. A naturopath, intelligent guy, I mean really intelligent. And he did his own study and his own research on this, and he came up with this huge biblical argument. Huge. And he said, please let me share it with you. I said, okay. So I listened to him for a couple of hours, share these things. And said, I said, I just have two questions for you. And I said, show me how this fits. And show me how this fits. And I gave him two things. And he said, I never thought of that. And let me do some research and study that. And there's no way he can harmonize them. It's impossible. But from that day to this, he hasn't gotten back with me to show me how they harmonize. But he hasn't given it up yet, to my knowledge. But this is one of those winds of doctrine that are tearing apart
people.
Not just people who believe the truth about God, not just Sabbath keepers, Seventh-day Sabbath keepers, but even people from other denominations are being misled by this, and now they're going to be harder to reach with the true Sabbath. Revelation 14, verses 9 to 11. The third angel is mentioned here, and he brings a warning to not worship the beast, and we have been talking about the beast, his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or his hand. So there are several things that we need to watch out for here, and not to worship the beast or his image or receive his mark. And we're going to be talking about what that mark is tomorrow night. But I will tell you now that the Sabbath is a life or death message.
Amen.
I want to share a few thoughts here about how to observe the Sabbath. Since it's such a vital question, and it's going to determine whether we receive the seal of God or not, we better know how we ought to observe it. I shared this with a group in Philippines about 6 months ago, and these were people that had been Seventh-day Adventists for most of their life, and the young people that are in their 20s and 30s now, all their life. And when I shared some of these things, they began to justify some of the actions that they were doing. And they ended up rejecting just point blank rejecting the inspiration of the messenger. And they had asked for baptism for about a number of them. How many of them?
Eight adults and six children.
And I said, well, I need to study some things with you before we do a baptism. And I spent some time going over some things. And the Sabbath, proper Sabbath observance, is one of those things. You know, when David attempted to bring the ark to Jerusalem, they didn't follow God's instruction quite exactly. They put it on a cart. Instead of carrying it like they were supposed to, they put it on a cart. And no one was supposed to touch it except the high priest on that one day a year. And as they were having a joyous occasion bringing this into Jerusalem, Uzzah, it tells us, put forth his hand and took hold of the ark because the oxen were shaking it as they were rolling along. And Uzzah was smitten dead. It says, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. Uzzah knew better. He knew that he was not to touch that ark. But the first injunction had been ignored. That is to carry it on by poles. They had poles that would go through rings on the ark, and then these priests would carry it. They ignored that injunction. And now the second thing didn't seem quite so bad. And he reached out and tried to steady it. Seemingly good motives. We can have good motives for what we do. We can have sincerity. But God requires more than that. He requires us to know what is a thus saith the Lord. We want to know how God wants us to observe the Sabbath. How God wants us to observe holy things, not how we think we ought to observe holy things.
God does not kill.
David was displeased and David was afraid. I can't bring that ark in here. And he questioned in his heart the justice of God. It was a divine judgment. Let me back up. Notice, in Patriarchs and Prophets, it tells about this story, and it reminds us that the Lord could not accept the service because it was not performed in accordance with his directions. We find a similar instance with Cain and Abel. Cain brought an offering, but he brought fruit, and God had said, bring a sacrifice. In Isaiah 58, we read that we are to turn away our feet from doing our own pleasure. Doing our own pleasure on the Sabbath is a violation of the Sabbath.
Yes. Right.
That's a principle that will go a long ways if we follow it.
Yes.
We'll get a lot of instruction from that. Not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words. Then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. So God promises a really special blessing on those that will keep the Sabbath as God intended it to be kept. We're told here in a book called Testimonies for the Church. Testimonies for the Church. We're told that we should jealously guard the edges of the Sabbath. Remember that every moment is consecrated holy time. Whenever it is possible, employers should give their workers the hours from Friday noon until the beginning of the Sabbath. Give them time for preparation that they may welcome the Lord's day with quietness of mind. By such a course, you will suffer no loss even in temporal things. How many of us are scurrying up to the last minute and even a few minutes late in trying to get the last little preparations done? Before the setting of the sun, let the members of the family assemble to read God's word, to sing and pray. There's need of reform here, for many have been remiss. We need to confess to God and to one another. So this would be a real good thing to do, to gather together before the sun sets, before the Sabbath begins, to welcome it in with family worship. And right now, sun sets in about 2 minutes, and I'd like to invite us to pause, and we'll be wrapping this up real shortly, but wanted us to take a moment and just welcome the Lord into our midst, into our presence on this Sabbath day. So if you would kneel with me. Brother Junkerstock, would you lead us in prayer?
Yeah. Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful to come into your holy Sabbath and into your rest. And we ask your blessing upon this day, this day that you have already blessed. And especially we ask your blessing upon us so that we can faithfully observe this day as you want us to observe it. Thank you for Jesus Christ, who is our righteousness. And we want to think about the fact that you create this earth during 6 days, and that you sanctify the Sabbath, but also that this work of creation is a type of the redemption that you want to accomplish in us. So we ask you your blessing in our lives and during the Sabbath upon all of us. And we are so thankful to be your children, and we pray thee in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God also desires us to mark the time when the sun goes down on Sabbath. As the sun goes down, let the voice of prayer and the hymn of praise mark the close of the sacred hours and invite God's presence through the cares of the week of labor. Beautiful instruction. And just as we read in Exodus, it says, on Friday, let the preparation for the Sabbath be completed. See that all the clothing is in readiness, that all the cooking is done. Let the boots be blacked. In other words, shined, polished, cleaned, and the baths be taken. It is possible to do this. If you make it a rule, you can do it. Now I heard some arguments. Oh, but you know, bathing is not like it used to be. We can just turn on the faucet and my brothers and sisters, I lived for a year with no bathroom, much less a shower in Philippines. And right now we haul our water. It's not that different. You just scoop the water out of a pail instead of turning on the faucet. It's not like it requires a lot of work to to just pick it up and pour it over you. And so that's not the issue, how much work it requires. God wants us clean before the Sabbath. Now, I'm not going to take an extreme position and say that if you go out and fall in a mud puddle on Sabbath, you can't go and clean yourself up. But the dirt you got on you during the week should be clean before the Sabbath begins. There was a special work of reformation in the days of Nehemiah. And part of that reformation included setting things in order when it came to Sabbath observance. Yeah. And he prohibited buying and selling and even preparing to sell. He wouldn't let them lodge outside the gates with their things to be ready to come in first thing when the gates were open after Sabbath. So, but here's a point that I fear that we often travel on this day when it might be avoided. In harmony with the light which the Lord has given in regard to the observance of the Sabbath, we should be more careful about traveling on the boats or cars on this day. In these matters, we should set a right example before our children and youth. So, it's almost as if she were here in the 21st century observing what we're doing, because it fits us pretty exactly. Tells exactly what we're doing. It says, if we desire the blessing promised to the obedient, we must observe the Sabbath more strictly. In order to reach the churches that need our help and to give them the message that God desires them to hear, it may be necessary for us to travel on the Sabbath. But so far as possible, we should secure our tickets and make all necessary arrangements on some other day. When starting on a journey, we should make every possible effort to plan so as to avoid reaching our destination on the Sabbath. If we were doing our own business, we should feel it a breach of the fourth commandment to travel on the Sabbath. At one church that I was sharing this with, the brethren said, oh, that's not possible in our day and age. If you live in the city, that's not possible. If you're a professional, that's not possible. That's only possible if you're a Bible worker or a minister. One of them is a teacher, and she doesn't get off work till 5, and then she's got to travel 2 hours through traffic, and the sun always sets at 6 or thereabouts, and so she arrives an hour after Sabbath. A couple of the others there said, we're lawyers, and we have to work till 5 o'clock, and then we've got to travel 3 hours through traffic to get home. So we get home around 8, and then we got to take our showers and cook and prepare the meal for Sabbath. And sun sets at 6 o'clock. And I said, you have to do that? And yes. And I question, do we have to, brothers and sisters? If you have to quit your job, what's more important, God or our temporal affairs here? But I believe if we are determined and take steps by faith, God can open doors that we don't see possible to open. God can move upon our employer, or He can give us a better job. Or we can get self-employed. God has 1,000 options. Yes. You know, when I hear that lack of faith, it disappoints me to see that in God's people, making excuses. Oh, we can't do it. like it's impossible. Well, what's impossible with God?
Nothing.
Nothing. David and his people had assembled to perform a sacred work, and they had engaged in it with glad and willing hearts, but the Lord could not accept the service because it was not performed in accordance with his directions. Is God's explicit directions important?
Yes.
And how much more important is it when it comes to the Sabbath, the great test question? And when laws of the land begin to be enacted that restrict and prohibit us from observing the Sabbath, how easy is it going to be if we're already compromising now? What are we going to do then? May God help us. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we love and praise you, and we thank you for giving us the Sabbath, this instrument by which we can be sanctified and receive the character of God. I pray that we can observe it the way you would have us to observe it, that we can be formed into the image of God and once again represent our Creator to the world and to the universe. I pray that you will convict and convert our hearts, transform us, and those things which we think are difficult and maybe impossible to our minds, remind us that it's possible, that all things are possible with you, and nothing is too hard. And we commit ourselves into thy care and keeping and pray for a rich measure of thy Spirit upon this Sabbath day. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.